The all-seeing eye.
That's awesome.
Hello,
Keep everybody
folks.
on their toes.
I believe we are live right now. We are here today playing Elder Scrolls Online. My name is Bryant Francis. I am joined today by two fine folks, Alex and Rich. Alex, can you say hi and introduce yourself?
Sure, Bryant. Hey, this is Alex Warra from Gamasutra.
Yep, and Rich?
And hey, everybody, I'm Rich Lambert. I'm the creative director on Elder Scrolls Online.
Nice. Sweet. So we are here today because Elder Scrolls Online this month is launching the One Tamriel update. And this was interesting to us. Oh, sweet. We have people in the chat already. KMC Susker. Sorry, I might mispronounce some names. Zoss Gina Bruno. And Exoa Draconis. And X-Reaper 205. Well, thank you all for joining us. I'm super excited to get to play with you all today. So we're playing Elder Scrolls Online here because this month you all are launching the One Tamriel update, which introduces some major changes to the entirety of Elder Scrolls Online, not just like a new content or new area thing. Rich, can you sort of introduce what those changes are?
Yeah, so the goal with One Tamriel is to really remove barriers from the game. So with One Tamriel, we removed the level barriers. Everybody is battle leveled now, so it doesn't matter what level you are. You can go anywhere in the world and play with anybody. Mm-hmm. And then we also removed the alliance barriers.
Yeah.
So you can play with everybody, not just people in your own alliance.
Yeah. Those are interesting. I think those are interesting things because it's a trend in MMORPGs, and our MMORPG design is to move that way, which is interesting just because it's kind of an opposite of what a lot of these games that use it launch on. So today, I will be piloting Rain Coat here, as you see. She is a Nordic Dragon Knight. I decided to roleplay as, like, an angry grandma. Go full Mad Max on this.
Awesome.
She does not know...
Do you have a backstory in mind?
All I can say is her name... apparently, aside from the game's backstory, she's just kind of, like, she's old, and she's a fighter, and she's angry. And we're figuring everything else from there. Very improv. But the only thing I need to say is, Raincoat doesn't know her name is a pun, because there are no raincoats in Tamriel. It is medieval times.
Is that canon, Rich? Can you confirm that?
I'm sure they have some kind of garment that they wear in Tamriel that
but it's like
keeps them dry.
Just not raincoats. This is one of the stupid things I do when I'm playing video games. But yeah, so we're going to load in here. We're only level 6, but to start things off, so Rich, can you sort of explain how ZeniMax Online decided, like, how and why you all decided to do this and what the process was for creating this kind of open Tamriel?
Yeah, so it was something that we've been talking about for a long time. You know, it's that, you know... Why are the level barriers there? Like, what does it really afford you, right? Like, you touched on it a little bit earlier where you said this is kind of the thing. Levels and level banding is something that, you know, a lot of games do because it makes sense and people are used to it. But when you really sit back and think about it, it's just this arbitrary thing, right? Like, well, why does the world do that, right? And so while we were, you know, making the game and building it, we had this idea. It's something that we, you know, we talked about, but it was such a dramatic shift from all the other games out there, and it was such a massive change to the world that we deemed it was too risky to do initially. And so what we did is, as we started releasing new DLC packs, we started testing out how the levelless world would work. You know, Orsinium was really the first PvE, full-on PvE version of that no levels, where you go to the zone, you're battle leveled, you can play with everybody in your alliance, but level didn't matter. And players overwhelmingly told us, this is fantastic. We love this. This is great. And that was really, you know, Orsinium was really the time where we were like, okay, we should do this. What does this actually mean across the entire game? And that was a huge effort by the team to go in and actually do that.
So let's dive into a little bit more, because it would seem from an outsider's perspective that designing a game with like level hierarchies, like zones, like designing the actual geography based on player level, mm-hmm. like that would be very difficult to undo or to adapt to if you just got rid of that level requirements. Like how does that change how you approach game design, and what did you have to do to retrofit the game?
We had to do a lot of things. We had to think about, you know, everything from, you know, what happens when a player doesn't have all the tools. You know, as you're leveling up and getting more experience and whatnot, you're unlocking more skills. So how does the player deal with a 3-pole when they're battle level versus a 1-pole? You know, those kinds of things. So flow and navigation is one. But just how do we determine how to battle level the players? What do we do? You know, some games do scaling down, some do scaling up, some do this really cool kind of hybrid of, you know, it's almost percentage based, you know. And so we had to find the thing that worked for us. And as a player, I much prefer having always having the power that I earned there. So I'm not a huge fan of downscaling. So we wanted to upscale everything. And so as we started going through and just navigating the world and playing through the world, we started looking at, well, how do the monsters look? How do they work and feel? You know, in the initial zones, a lot of the base popping was done with low levels in mind. So it was single poles and 2 poles. And in a lot of the advanced zones, it was three poles or more. So we had to do a lot of that, looking at those, evaluating what critical path was and where players were going to go, and, you know, make changes to the base pop in that regard.
Can you just really quick, just in case our audience, my MMO jargon's a little out of date. Can you just sort of explain what some of those specific nouns that you use there are?
So like base pop?
Base pop, poles, etc.
Poles and stuff? Okay, yeah. So base pop is what we call laying out all of the monsters in the encounters. So, you know, if you're looking at your screen now, you're fighting some guys and they're in this big open field. And so base pop is, you know, setting up those encounters, and there's generally rules associated with those encounters. So you're in one of the starter islands, and so you're gonna see more solo monsters, and maybe in one or two with some monsters that are walking around or pathing. And so, you know, a solo monster is what we call a solo pole or a 1-pole. And if there's a group of three together, that's a 3-pole because you're gonna get all three at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And in looking at those, you know, when you look at a 3-pole, the monsters have different combat packages. So you could get a healer and a more of a tanky type guy, and then a ranged person, or a ranged monster.
Mm-hmm.
And so that changes over the dynamic of fighting. That changes if they were all, say, three healers, or they were all three tanky type. Right, and so it's a lot of that is what encounters or encompasses base pop.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I this kind of gets back to what we were talking about a second ago, and what I really do want to talk about more, which is like the core aspect of MMORPG design, like area design, because, you know, it seems like if we're talking about dynamic level scaling, like there are a bunch of numbers that you're tweaking, and there are a bunch of like ability scores, stuff like that's all something you do, like, you know, it's just like changing the game engine and stuff, but like the actual layout and encounter design, like part of that is tied to a player's abilities. So like it seems like from the outside here watching Brian play, that before you had dynamic leveling, like a more difficult area might not just have harder enemies, but like more enemies and trickier encounters. And so now that you're opening this up and allowing players to go anywhere they want without being fettered by their levels, like, did you have to change the way encounters are designed? Did you have to go in and retrofit that kind of stuff? And, like, how do you decide how to do that as a designer?
So, to some degree, we did. You know, one of the rules that we kind of have here, and we've established now with all of our newer content that we're building, is, you know, the critical path, the storyline of a zone or a map should be soloable. You should be able to wander around and, you know, anybody of any level should be able to go in there and play it and experience it. And then when you get off that kind of critical path, then that's when you start running into, you know, the group bosses and the dark anchors and the more of the group content. And like you said, a lot of that wasn't really in the initial implementation of the zones when we built it, because we were level banded and we assumed that player was going to be between this level and this level, so we could tailor encounters for that.
Right.
As part of the one Tamriel thing, we have to go back and look at some of those encounters. You know, go through the critical path in the zones and make sure that a solo player could participate in that content.
So it's more than, it's really a lot more than just like tweaking numbers up and down. It's not just like going into a spreadsheet and then like applying a formula that scales it to level. Like there's a lot more work than that.
There definitely is. I mean, that's your first pass. You know, we're a very iterative studio.
Yeah.
So we put something in, we test it, we make changes, we test it, so on and so forth. And so, you know, the very first time that we did our, okay, we're turning it on in all the zones, we went through and we started testing it, and yeah. There were places where, holy cow, this monster one-shots you, or holy cow, this encounter's impossible, and we have to make tweaks to that. So that was the bulk of the effort in going through and you know, iterating on this change, outside of the massive overhaul to the itemization. But yeah. That's another topic.
Yeah, really quick.
I'm curious.
Oh, go ahead, sorry. I'm going to pull in a question from the chat. This isn't quite the design, like our usual design talk stuff, but my name, Elias, would like to know if the Grim Harlequin motif is exclusive to the Crown Store? Just giving him a little nudge there.
Right. Oh, so that's for our witches event that we have coming. And it is, yeah.
Oh, it's so my name, Elias. That should hopefully help you out. Cool. Alex, you had a question.
Yeah, I mean, I was curious to know... you know, because one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you, Rich, is because I'm so fascinated by MMORPG design in general. And, like, what is your guiding... Does the studio have a guiding principle you're aware of for, like, how difficult an encounter should be? Because you're talking about going back through and being like, oh, wow, you know, this guy now one-shot. So, like, how do you know when to draw the line between when to underpower or, like, depower an encounter versus, like, leave it hard and allow that kind of threat of danger to exist in your world?
So we have different areas where... we can, I don't want to say kill players, but where we can really crank the difficulty up to, you know, level 13.
Right. Where we can make them scream a little.
Right. And we have a team that just loves doing that stuff. You know, the dungeon team, that's where they really shine, right? They go in and they make these 12-person encounters, or they make, you know, Maelstrom Arena, which is more of a hardcore solo type thing. Mm-hmm. So we try to put that content in the game for players, but it's very opt-in. And in the zones, when you're kind of going through and exploring, we try to be very mindful of what an average player is going to do. You know, somebody that is more into the role play and in the story and not necessarily the numbers. And we actually have a few people that is their entire job, is to play like a player. You know, our lead content designer, Jeremy, you know, whenever he's testing any new content or reviewing new content, he plays as a brand new player with a non-optimal build, with non-optimal gear setting at the lowest possible level, to see if he can get through it. You know, standing in all of the AoEs or in area effect abilities and, you know, getting hit by every monster attack, just to make sure that, you know, those players, it is feasible for them.
Yeah. Follow up on Alex's question. What's your kind of general take for designing encounters anyway? Like where do you sort of start in terms of thinking about what you want a player to do for these kind of things and stuff?
There's a whole slew of questions that we ask ourselves when going through and designing encounters. You know, is this intended for a solo person? Is this intended for a group? If it's intended for a group, you know, what are each of the roles doing in the group? Mm-hmm. You know, how do you make the encounter interesting for, you know, we have 4-person groups, so... in general, it's a healer, a tank, and 2 damage dealers. So what is the tank doing that's interesting? What is the healer doing that's interesting? What are the damage dealers doing that are always interesting? And it's not necessarily just tank the big guy or heal everybody or damage the monsters, right? So that's the biggest question. And then going through, you know, once we've established what that encounter is, then we start going through and coming up with the mechanics, the things that we want the players to do.
Yeah.
And over the years, we've kind of learned what works really well in our engine and what doesn't. And so we tend to move more towards what works. But we still do experiment. You know, a lot of times, the dungeon team is the one that does the most amount of experimentation.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Brian.
No, you go for it. I'll dance on
the water. I just am curious.
That's a creepy eye, by the way.
Yeah, thanks.
I feel right behind you.
I should explain this. I don't think it's ever come up, but it's usually in the stream somewhere. We have a cat, and we love our cat very much, and we have good friends. And one of our friends took a photo of our cat and put it on one of those make-your-own pillow company
websites.
That's
so amazing.
It's terrifying, but comfy. But back to Elder Scrolls. I'm curious to know, like, this game has been in operation for a little over, like, 2 years, right? Like, it debuted in 2014. Yeah, and, you know, it's gone through a lot of changes since then, and it continues to change and evolve. And, like, I'm so curious to know, what is the state of MMORPG design in 2016? Like how has it, even in your, like, I know it's been a while for you, but, like, the genre has existed for even longer. But even in the couple of years you've been working on ESO, like, how has the needs of the player base changed, and how has the industry changed? And, like, what have you learned in 2 years of trying to maintain this game? In no pressure.
A lot. Right. Like, that's a huge, huge question, right? You know, I've been, you know, involved in the games industry for 20 plus years now, and, you know, my passion is MMOs. You know, mm-hmm. I've played MMOs since, oh boy, The Realm was probably the very first one that I would consider an MMO, you mm-hmm. know, and then went to UO and, you know, EverQuest and on and on and on, right? And so I think that the thing you've seen over the years and how the MMO industry has kind of morphed and changed, it's gone a little bit, it's moved more away from the hardcore only niche type. Mm-hmm. Into more mainstream, where a lot more players are starting to get in and experience it. And as a result, they're starting to get more player friend. Mm. You know, they're starting to focus more on storytelling. You know, those RPG aspects that everybody loves from the single player games, you're starting to see even more of those come into the MMOs. And I think where MMOs really shine, you know, the thing that I love about them is they're so social. You know, I played MMOs in the past for 7+ years, and I would totally say that I didn't play them for as long as I did because the game was amazing. I mean, that was part of it, but it was my social circle, the circle that I was playing with all the time. I logged in to talk to those people. I logged in to play with those people. You know, when somebody really needed to, you know, farm something or a piece of gear or whatever, I would go and play with them. I didn't need it, but I would go do it because I enjoyed that camaraderie and that friendship. And so that's why MMOs are so interesting to me. And I think, you know, as we progress even more so, you're going to see even more and more social aspects come into MMOs.
I think that's kind of interesting because that's kind of I guess I'm heading down there in a second. Like, I've been thinking about sort of the state of MMOs as I see them, because I played I mostly played a lot of World of Warcraft back in the day, and just trying to keep my life together has made me swear off the addictive MMOs somewhat. But
yep,
I absolutely think that the social element is way more important now, but it's to the extent that, like, it's people bringing their friends from the outside world into the game just to kind of hang out. Like, it's a way that a lot of people, like, build a social circle and then just spend time together. Which is, I think, greatly shaped the design, because it's not so much about living, even though the storytelling aspect is a big...
Cannibal.
Ignore that.
You're fine, you got this.
Ignore that. even though that's a big thing about it, even though the storytelling is a big thing, the somewhat, like, living in a fantasy world dream that I think started the genre, it's something that Raph Koster writes a lot about, with his stuff on, like, he writes some blogs for Gamasutra and stuff about this kind of thing, that's kind of faded away as the genre has gone mainstream, is that it's not so much a world to escape our world, but more like a kind of a online hangout spot for people.
Well, I think it's both, right? Like, they're not mutually exclusive.
Right, yeah, but, like,
the world setting and the lore and the storytelling, and what keeps people grounded in the game and keeps them coming back is the social aspects.
I think it's interesting to talk about how you design for a social space rather than a pure game, because when you design a single player game, you are focused purely on your player and their satisfaction, their experience, their challenge. But when you're building a game like this and iterating upon a game like this and building new encounters and new zones, like, you're thinking, I assume you're thinking about more than just, like, how to satisfy that player
you know, playing by themselves. You also need to think about, like, how to encourage sociability and how to encourage, like, interaction in the zone and stuff. So, like, how do you tackle that as a game designer?
That's another one of those things that's it's really hard to do because, you know, like I said earlier, you engage people, you get them interested in the world by having this really tight, really cool solo experience. Mm-hmm. Right? But what keeps them around is that multiplayer experience, is that I'm playing with my friends. And so, you know, with ESO, you know, we absolutely wanted to make sure that there were very strong stories and storytelling and places that the player could go by themselves. Mm-hmm. But then we had to find ways of introducing basically what we call soft grouping in the world, right? Which is like the group bosses and the dark anchors and, you know, those kinds of things where as you're progressing through the world, you stumble upon other people that are trying to do this stuff and it's a little too hard for one person to do. But other people, because they're around, they'll naturally just help you. And so with us, one of the first things we did was kind of change the way what we call monster tagging works. So in a lot of games, you know, the first person that hits the monster or the last person that kills the monster is the one that gets credit for it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, in ESO, we changed that. So now anybody that participates in the encounter or the event, they get credit for it. So, you know, you're not... you're not competing against other players for those monsters and that XP in the world. You're working with them.
What just happened? That was really
you
weird.
You fallen off? Oh, you got knocked off by the
I think he knocked me off, but then like there was like a little red line that like, covered this area.
Yeah, it seems fine. You're all right, right?
I just fell down again.
So yeah, the you know, it's a challenge in an MMO, you know, in a multiplayer game to kind of remove some of that player-to-player competition over, you know, monsters and resources and things like that.
Yeah.
You know, we have the, if you want to go kill somebody, go to Cyrodiil and you can PvP and do all that, and we just put dueling in for one Tamriel where you can challenge other players to duels. But outside of that, we want to make sure that, you know, you're collaborating with people and not competing against them.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Just to bring up kind of a thing from the chat, I meant to fall that time. Wonder Dude is asking something about the console version of the game. Hopefully someone in the chat can help him answer his question about the download time. But, because I think I see some of your folks in here. And I'll ask you actually a follow-up about that, about the tagging in a sec. But,
Okay.
I'm kind of curious, like, what, so, this, I haven't actually gotten to talk to a lot of developers who work on both console and, console and PC MMOs. Is there any kind of difference or anything you have to account for when you're working on all the PC and console?
I mean, the next gen consoles, you know, the PS4 and the Xbox One, they're pretty powerful right now.
Yeah.
And so we haven't really had to modify the game that much in order to run on either.
Yeah.
Which is great. You know, a lot of our time, you know, working on the console stuff is working with first party to make sure we're adhering to all of their guidelines.
Yeah.
You know, they have a very strict set of guidelines and APIs that you have to call, especially when it comes to the friends, you know, the social aspects of the game.
Yeah.
And so that's where a lot of our time is spent. We did have to, you know, rework the user interface to support to switch from mouse and keyboard to controller.
Yeah.
And so that was a huge, huge undertaking. But for the most part, you know, these next gen consoles are super powerful, and so we didn't have to really change much.
Yeah.
I have some more like thoughts about that. Brian, you wanted to ask about tagging?
Yeah, the enemy tagging. I'm sorry, did I miss? Did you explain like how you guys changed that to make this work, like the enemy tagging work, to make sure it was more social and not competing? Did you? I may have been focused on my jumping errors when that happened. Yeah, I just remember that being a big. I just remember that being a big thing in World of Warcraft was, like, everyone was waiting for, like, certain, like, open world bosses to spawn, so there'd be lines to, like, kill a monster sometimes, and that was amusing.
Yeah, whoever tagged it first basically got credit, and, yeah, we did things a little bit different.
Yeah, nice.
Alec. It's funny, because, like, so many people talk about those old design tropes, like corpse running or lining up for a boss, and it's been so long now that, like, you get a lot of... You get the rose-colored glasses effect. People are like, oh, I really miss those. And I think those kind of like designs should exist, so people can see them. But I really don't know that they're actually worth going back to in any meaningful sense.
Oh, no, no, no.
Sorry, go ahead, Brian.
No,
I mean, we've had debate over debate over debate over, you know, what does death mean in an MMO, right?
Yeah.
You know, and there's a bunch of different camps, you know. You know, death should be meaningful. It should be painful. You should want to avoid it. But death is also a quit moment. And yeah. So, you know, like, oh, I just died. Well, turn it off. Go do something else, right?
Yeah.
So you have to find that happy medium, that happy balance, and it's definitely harder. You know, it goes back to, you know, what I said earlier with the, you know, MMOs are moving out of the hardcore niche and more into the mainstream, and therefore you have to think more about, you know, how do mainstream players play games? What are their interests? While also trying to appeal to the hardcore.
I think you're uniquely suited to talk to our audience of game developers about how exactly people do play MMORPGs, because like. There just aren't that. I mean, there are some titans left, but there just aren't that many people who have the opportunity to work on a massive multiplayer online game the way you do. So, like, what are people looking for these days?
I would say, based on what I know of our player base, you know, they're looking for story. They're looking for high production quality in the story, not necessarily just some text boxes, but. You know, NPCs that talk to you, you know, they're looking for a world that feels alive and open. So when you're running around exploring, there's things to find in the world, treasure chests, notes, books, those kinds of things. And then, you know, that's kind of one side of the player base. And the other side of the player base in MMOs, they are there to compete against other people, right? They are there to be the best. They're the item chasers. They're the achievers. They have to do all of those things. So you have to make sure you have something for everybody.
It reminds me of, are you familiar with the HBO show Westworld that everyone's talking about right now?
Oh, nice.
Everybody here is talking about it. Yes.
have you seen it?
I have not. I'm a binge watcher, and so I want to wait until it's done and then binge on it.
Mm-hmm. It inspired a conversation in our work Slack, and Brian brought up the point that like a lot of online spaces don't seem designed to account for people who want to just hang out in online spaces. Like your average open world game doesn't, like, it's only designed to let you do missions or do violence. Like, it's not really designed to let you sit down at a cafe and listen to people talk. Mm-hmm. But MMORPGs, more than almost any other game, typically are. So I'd be curious to know if you can speak to it. Like, how do you design for players that don't want to engage with quests particularly, or don't want to go to PvP, and they just want a space to hang out? Like, how do you build another world for these people?
That's where a lot of the social mechanisms come into place, right? You know, you know, guilds is the first thing that I always go to. And, you know, how do you equate your, or how do you create a social circle, right? Mm. And so with that, you know, that's where your guilds come in. You know, I have a guild, I invite people to it. It's the place where I can go and talk to people all the time. You know, with MMOs, a lot of times they have text chat. And so that right there is a built-in social mechanism. You can just talk to other players.
Sure.
Outside of that, you know, there's various, you know, voice comm software out there that you can use to, once people are in your group, you can give them your TeamSpeak or Discord or whatever, and then go in and chat with them there. But within the game mechanisms, you know, with us, we knew socialization was a big thing. And so that's why we looked at things like, well, why are guilds important? You know, what kind of features can we hang on guilds to make them a little bit tighter knit? That's where the idea of guild traders came in. Mm-hmm. Rather than a global auction house, having guild traders so that in order for people to participate in the system, they have to be a part of these trade guilds. You know, we would love to do more things with that as well, but those are just, you know, base ideas, right? You know, our trials, which are 12-person content, you know, you need 11 other people to do them. That therefore you gravitate towards guilds in order to, you know, find, you know, a bunch of people that are of like mind.
Brian, are you in a guild? Have you found a good guild yet?
Raincoat is a solo wanderer. She is driven by, she is still trying to figure out what the hell is going on, because she started her day awake in a strange other world and got sent back to Arwen, and there's a lot of proper nouns being thrown at her that she's still trying to parse, but you know, like maybe the day will come, maybe, but right now she's just on a, you know, kind of point me into where I need to swing my axe kind of mindset. That's kind of fun. Sorry, go ahead. I was about to start riffing. This is awkward silence.
I was going to ask, because Rich, you mentioned that you've been working in the game industry for quite a while. I know it hasn't always been on MMORPGs. I know you've worked on some a variety of games across different platforms. We don't need to dig into your full history as a game developer if you don't want to, but I'd be curious to know how your prior work has inspired and influenced the way you approach design on this project.
So I started in the industry as a tester and kind of worked my way through the ranks.
What was your first game? What was the first game you tested?
FIFA 95 for the SNES? 96 for the SNES?
Nice.
Long, long time ago. It was originally supposed to be a summer job in between college semesters kind of thing, and it turned into a full-time job. And it's been 21 years? 22 years? When I got into the industry, I didn't even know that there was an industry, right? Like, I thought it was just an engineer and a programmer and a designer got together in a room and
make a game. Yeah.
Right? So, testing opened my eyes to the madness that is game development, right? You know, like, it's not a perfect science. And so I didn't realize that at the time. And so over the years, as I, you know, tested these things and got to see, you know, the types of bugs that get implemented and why they get implemented and how they get implemented, I think that really set me up, you know, for when I moved into production and then later on into design of, you know, what are the things to look out for? You know, what are the things that players look for when they're playing a game? You know, how do they play games? You know, as a tester, I got to test 50 some odd games over the course of 6 years, 7 years. So I got to see a bunch of different design philosophies, and I got to work with a bunch of different developers to kind of see how they worked, you know, and compare and contrast that, which was really good, right? Being able to do that. And then, like I said, I've been playing MMOs forever, and I used to be a pretty hardcore gamer. I'm not as hardcore now, but every time a new game came out, I would play it and dissect it and try to figure out, you know, what was the designer thinking here? Why were they making this decision versus this decision? Mm-hmm. And I would try to break the game. You know, well, I bet you they didn't think about doing it this way, and so I would try to break it, and when I found bugs, I was like, yes, I'm awesome. And when I didn't, I'm like, wow, they're really clever, awesome. So,
How does it feel to be on the other side of that? Like what sucks. Do you think people...
No, it's good. You never want to make a mistake. You never want to introduce a bug. And it pains me when they get through, but for the most part, you know, we don't make a ton of mistakes. And so, you know, those ones that do stick, that get through and do come out, they hurt. Every time there's a bug, it pains me. It really pains me.
Real quick, I actually want to take a question from the chat real quick. Wonder Dude is curious. We were talking about, I think we brought it up because we were talking about social stuff earlier. There's been some talk in the chat about interacting with objects and furniture. And I think this is a great thing to talk about for a second, because as people in the games industry, we sort of know why certain things are the way they are. But then there's the things that sneak up on us when players are like, oh, well, why can't we do this? And you're like, well, why would you want to do that? But I think the furniture thing is a great...
Sometimes it happens.
Yeah. I think the furniture thing's a great question, because I don't think a lot of MMOs let you do anything with furniture. Can you sort of talk about the thought, what's at your end of that behind that?
Yeah, so there's a lot of actually really great talks on, you know, designing and designing world spaces and whatnot. But... you know, when you get in there and you start looking at it, you know, sometimes you just don't want the monotony of real world in your fantasy world.
Yeah.
Other times, you know, when you're looking at, say, a chair or a door. A door is probably a better example, but you know, in the real world, a door is a door. You don't really think about, well, how does it open? How heavy is it? What sounds does it make? Is it locked? Is it unlocked? Like, you don't think of all of those things. as a you know, in the real world, it's just the door.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the MMO space, or just in games in general, you have to think about, well, how does a monster pass through it? You know, what happens if the monster's too big and gets to the door, right? Like, all of those things get added on top of it's just a door.
Yeah.
Right. And the other part of it, too, is when you're building the world, a lot of times, you know, the artists and the world builders are really creative, and they'll, what I call, kitbash. And they'll take a chair and the door and they'll kind of place them in this way so that they look really, really cool. But you don't really have any control as a designer of how they're being put together. And so if you were to basically blanket systematize that all chairs work this way, well, what happens when you run into that case where the door is on top of the chair or the chair is upside down on the world and knocked over and say somebody goes to click on it to sit in it? You know, it's how do you work through all of those edge cases and those crazy things?
Yeah. Wonder Dude's only follow up is that interactive chairs would be cool in guild housing. And I do.
Yeah, that would be really cool.
I do hate to compare you to another game, but I do recall in World of Warcraft, actually, I remember oddly spending lots of time, like, they Blizzard had placed interactive chairs in lots of environments, so you could just, for no gameplay purpose, it was literally just so you could sit down, which it was, like, there was no other gameplay thing it served, aside from being a right-click thing, and was just a little, one of the little things they were able to accomplish as far as chairs. You said
Well, I was just going to jump in and agree with you, because I also spent a lot of time in World of Warcraft a couple years ago, and, like, finding chairs or benches you could sit at, I would totally just sit down while I was going to log out or walk away.
It's really cool. Yeah. And in a lot of cases, those are special cases, right? You know, why does this chair work, but this chair doesn't? And how do you communicate that to the player, right? Other than I just go up to try and click on it, and I sit in this one and I don't in the other one.
Yeah,
and I will say it's interesting to compare the two because, you know, I mean, we're getting very granular, but, like, you know, there perhaps there are not any clickable chairs that I'm aware of in ESO, but I noticed when I played the game, I was very taken by the fact that there are, like, objects on tables that you can pick up and move around, like, very much like the games that you draw spiritual ties to, which is the Elder Scrolls games, and I found that to be very engaging in a weird way. Like, it made you feel embodied in a virtual world in a way that most MMOs don't.
Yeah.
It makes the world feel alive. It makes it feel like there's a purpose to the world. And I think that's the biggest thing. We call that Clickyville. You know, clickies. Mm. You know, all the things that you can run around in and click on and interact with. You know, the crates that I can open up, the dressers, you know, the food, all those kinds of things. You know, that was added in actually with a patch. It wasn't there at launch. That was part of our overall justice system that we added in to really make the world feel lived in and alive.
Yeah. Really quick, I actually just, it's funny you brought up the door thing. I think there's actually a very specific blog about this. The Door Problem by Liz England, which is somewhere on Gamasutra.
Yep.
It's literally, if you're a player and you ever want to know why doors are hard, feel free to look that up. It's on her own blog, and I think she put it on Gamasutra. But it's kind of like...
it's got like 60 points of why a door is not just a door. It's awesome. Yeah.
It's really good. In fact, in general, if you ever want to know why making games is hard, just go to Gamasutra and read any of the blogs.
Yeah. Self-promotional there. Also, feel
free
to...
plug there.
Please
little plug.
Feel free to subscribe to this channel for more developer chats like this one, if you're enjoying talking with Rich. Usually we save that for the end of the show, but for some reason, I just decided to bring it up right now. This guy's going to die. Bad day. He's having a bad day.
So, Rich, what do you think the future of MMO design looks like? Because it feels like ESO is out there, there's Guild Wars 2, there's World of Warcraft and EVE Online, and like, in the West, that's those are sort of the big ones that I can be aware of. Like, how do you think the design changes to further adapt to meet player needs going forward?
Well, I think, you know, first and foremost is, you know, I don't know that you're going to see kind of the traditional massive, massive, huge games, you know, coming out, you know, the in terms of just scale and size, right? They're really expensive and they're really risky. And so convincing somebody to allow you to, you know, take that risk is going to be a challenge, I think, number one. But outside of that, getting away from the financials, I think, honestly, the big things are going to be how can you better socially connect your players? What are the things that players are doing in-game you know, to work with each other, to build upon each other, you know, to develop those strong social ties. I think those are the big ones.
That reminds me, I was talking recently with John Smedley, who left Daybreak and who now is doing his own indie game venture. And we were talking about online game design because he, you know, he was involved with Sony Online and he, you know, like I spent a lot of time, like worked on EverQuest and EverQuest 2, like had a lot of like studied the way people play massive multiplayer online games. So what he told me was that like, and he had been talking to Ralph Koster several years ago too, and they had studied and like graphed out on average how many people a given player would interact with in the course of their time with a game, and it was never like 2,000. It was always like 200. On average, like people they would have conversations with that have meaningful interactions.
Isn't that Dunbar's number too? Which is like supposedly the number of people
it's like
that
150, 200 relationships that you can manage at a time.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And so his point to me was that like as neat as it was to be able to say you can have 2,000 people on this server, why do we really need to make games that have two like servers that have 2,000 people on them when you really just need 200 or 300 to get a very similar experience for a given player? And I'm not sure that I fully agree with that, but I think it's very interesting, the idea that like in the future you may see a tighter focus on social relationships and also like smaller online spaces. I don't know how we get from here to there. Like do you think that like rather than seeing a lot of big MMORPG projects, we're gonna see like a proliferation of sort of smaller indie ventures, kind of like little games, or do you see like established players trying to focus in and create smaller, more intimate experiences?
I think you're going to see both, honestly, right? You know, the indie scene is pretty amazing what those guys are doing. You know, even, you know, just outside of, you know, the mainstream kind of, you know, this is a big budget, you know, well, I guess if they're indie, they're not big budget, but, you know, looking at what they're doing and with a lot of like the Flash games, you know, and the HTML5 things, you know, there's tons of really amazing things that I have seen, you know, some of the indie guys, the smaller guys do to bring more of that socialization together. And I think, you know, you're going to see, like I said, a lot more smaller, more tightly focused games out there, you know, maybe not necessarily the size of, you know, an ESO or a WoW or, you know, a Tor or Guild Wars 2, you know, not necessarily as big as those, but you're going to see smaller, massively multiplayer games, which sounds funny, but smaller multiplayer games, right?
Not quite so massive.
Right.
I had two thoughts that your comments made me think of. One was that you have games like Destiny, which are kind of doing what Alex talked about. They're very big, and they have a lot of, you know, the large player base, but the players only have so much social interaction, like at a much smaller scale that maybe matches what Alex is talking about. You know, like 200 person, X number of people, not even 200 in a given instance of like, you know, the public areas. But the second thing that thought me, like I said, the mobile space, mobile online games are very like, I don't know, they're like, they seem like a big part of what you're talking about, because at in my experience with the field, they're like, you have places where like the server, like they don't necessarily focus on trying to get all these people into the same physical space, but even like a little lobby where all the characters are hanging out before you and your friends go off on missions. That's a very common feature in online like brawler games, which aren't even necessarily like, I don't know, like some of them, like some of the ones that I had previously worked with did have more raid-like experiences and looked like other MMOs. Others were like puzzle games where people still did similar things. So I think that's to build off your observation, the mobile space has certainly reshaped how MMOs work.
Yeah, I mean, I've played a bunch of, you know, idle games, you know, on sites like Kongregate and Armor Games and places like that, you know, where it's an idle game, but they have guilds and they have chat. And so like, that's another, you know, there is a social aspect. They get, you know, those guys are understanding that the way you get people to stay and play is develop social ties.
So yeah.
You're seeing it come everywhere now.
It reminds me, Rich, you mentioned you have been making games for a while and you've played a lot of MMOs. Have you ever made an MMO before this?
No, this is my first one. I've made a lot of big games, but this is my first one.
What was your biggest surprise? What was the most like surprising, frustrating, disappointing, exciting thing that happened when you sort of got involved in this project?
I think number one, the biggest one is just sheer scale. You know, size of it. You know, when you go to make a change, you know, to something that's existing, it's not just, oh, I change 50 things. It's, I change 10,000. Right. So it's size and scale is a big thing. You know, I worked, I was a producer on Oblivion and a producer for a while on Fallout 3 as well. And those are big games. But in Elder Scrolls Online, one of our zones is equivalent to Oblivion, right? So it gives you an idea of orders of magnitude in terms of, you know, quests and landmass and things like that. And so we have, I've lost count now, 25 zones in the game, overland zones in the game, something like that. So, yeah, it's just, it's a massive, massive game. And there's tons of people that all have to communicate and all understand that when they change something kind of upstream, how that trickles downstream to the very end product and how that works. So that was a lot of growing pains trying to figure that out and understand how that worked.
If you hadn't given, oh, go ahead, Brian.
I was gonna build on that with a quick, you know what, Alex, that's your question, mine's a whole nother thread of conversation, sorry.
No, I mean, I was just talking out loud. I was gonna say, you know, since this is a stream for everyone, but especially game developers and game designers, like, if you had to give any advice to fellow game developers and designers based on what you've learned on this project, what would it be? Again, no pressure.
Boy, I mean, there's lots of little lessons learned, right? You know, a lot of times, you know, when you're developing something, you spend a lot of time in pen and paper world trying to document exactly how the system works, all the little bells and whistles and how all that stuff works, and then you get to implementation and you kind of throw that out once it's been implemented and start iterating, and then you never go back to the updating the documentation afterwards. And so that's one of those examples of, you know, people downstream, you know, when the testers come in after things have been implemented, they look at the design doc and then they see what's in the game and they're like, what the F? This doesn't match. How does this work? And they, you know, their job is a lot harder. So, you know, updating your documentation is probably a, you know, it sounds simple and it sounds like a no-brainer, but actually spending the time to do it, you know, that will save your life in the long run. Mm-hmm. You know, simple things like naming conventions. Use them, establish them, don't ever change them, right? Like, yeah. Lots of those little things that... you know, you don't necessarily think of as a huge, massive deal, but, you know, they are super important.
Okay, Brian, I can take us in a totally different tangent.
All right, all right. So to illustrate my question, I'm going to walk back to the docs here. So I just thought this is a really cool thing that ESO does. And I know, again, a lot of games do this now. It's kind of like, I think it's an instancing or phasing thing. I think even WoW has it now. But we just saw something cool here where I went down to these docs in a like branching choice quest. Sorry, poor person who died. Oh, you're the bad guy. Never mind. So on these docks a second ago were the scene of a fight, and I was sitting here brawling my way through, you know, kind of just kicking ass, if you will. And now they're not. Now they're a clean place where these people are peacefully fishing. Can you sort of talk about the tech? Dang it. Can you talk about the technical ability?
You're good at, like, falling off.
I'm really good at falling off things. Can you talk about how you all like constructed these zones in open worlds that can, like, tell where players are on a quest line and change what's happening around them? Can you sort of talk about that?
Sure. Yeah. Make sure you loot that chest.
Can I unlock it? Am I good enough?
Let's watch as he tries to lockpick a chest. So yeah, we have a system in our game that we call layering. You know, other games call it phasing, whatever, but we have the ability to paint a zone or a subzone in the world that, or trigger volume in the world, that when the player enters it, we can use that as a means to change their phase, change their story, you know, put them in a different layer so that they can do things on their own. And then when they complete that, you know, they go back to the regular layer. And at launch, well, before launch, when we were building the game, we kind of fell in love with that because we loved the storytelling. We were so focused on the storytelling, and we kind of lost sight of the, hey, remember, we're a multiplayer game, and, hey, players want to play together. And so we had a lot of player separation issues where, you know, Alex, say you were on a step of a quest and I was on a different step of a quest, and when we walked into the same area, we couldn't see each other because we were on different layers.
Right.
And so we spent the first 6 months of the game being live trying to solve as many of those as we could so that it was always easy to find your friends. It was much easier to quest with one another. You didn't have to be so in lockstep. And so, you know, it's a great, fantastic tool. It's super powerful, but it can also get you in trouble if you don't always think of those separation issues.
So if you had to design this game right now, again, from scratch, what would you do?
Oh, boy. What would I do differently?
Yeah.
I don't know that we have... I mean, I love the way the game works right now. I love the way it plays. You know, I think hindsight is always 20/20, and so, you know, if I knew everything now that I did back then and had everything now tech-wise that I did, and was able to take that back, I think some of the quests would be set up a little differently so that there's not as many separation issues. I think I would focus a little bit more on the social interactions with players, you know, make sure that there's enough group activities in comparison to solo activities. Right. You know, part of the One Tamriel experience was to do a lot of that. So a lot of the group bosses we changed and updated, and a lot of the Dark Anchors we changed and updated so that they were more group activities instead of solo activities.
Yeah.
I think those would definitely be the big ones.
I do wonder something I've been thinking about since we started talking about this that I'm not sure how to bring up, but I really want to know is, like, how do you feel about working on a game that cannot be preserved? Because, you know, you spend so much time working on games that come in discs and can be, with some effort, like, pulled out of a thing or dumped and then played again. Mm-hmm. But ESO, whenever, you know, may ESO live forever, but, like, should it ever come to a close, like, there will be no easy way to ever have this experience again, or to talk about what you did or what you went through with other people and be able to show it to them. Like, how does that feel as a game designer to know that you're working on something ephemeral?
I mean, for me, I guess because I've been in the industry as long as I have, it doesn't really bother me. Like, I've got this, I'm super proud of the game. You know, I've been working on it since 2007. You know, I was one of the original developers on the game. And so it's kind of like, you know, having a kid, you know, my oldest was two when I started working on the game, or I guess he was four when I started working on the game. But, you know, it's just one of those things where, you know, you live it, you breathe it, you love it, and, you know, when it's done, it's done. You know, it doesn't really bother me. You know, I've worked on tons of single player games where, like you said, I have this disc in my, you know, office or in my bookshelf that says, yes, I did this thing, and it's great. But I have that too with this. I just can't ever load it back up again, right?
Right.
So,
how do you feel then about and this may be a hard question, about, like, the ability to, like, preserve older versions of the game somewhere. Like in World of Warcraft, they were struggling recently with the Australia server and people trying to run a version of Vanilla WoW, which is the game I am most familiar with. But Blizzard couldn't legally let them do that. How do you sort of feel about stuff like that?
Well, I mean, you have to protect your interests, right?
Yeah.
You know, you're a company, there's hundreds of people, you know, all working on this, their livelihoods depend on it. So yeah, you have to protect it.
Yeah.
You know, the traditional developers, the single player game developers, they still have those issues as well. You know, it's called pirating, right? You know, where they pirate their game and whatnot. So it's not, you know, unique to MMOs. It's definitely a games thing. And you know, I believe that, you know, you have to protect your interests.
Yeah. It's interesting just because we've heard a lot of opinions about that ever since that Australia's thing happened. And I think it's interesting that there's no right answer. And I think I'm glad that the game industry is willing to say there's no right answer and still figure it all out. You know, like, some people do want the historical preservation, but then there's absolutely a need to protect a company's interest. Because that's a very big problem. If I just know from the raw text of copyright law, it just becomes a very big problem.
Yeah, I do think there is a need for preservation of the game industry's history and of its works. But I also think, Rich, you have a very mature perspective insofar as, like, I know some designers who are very concerned that, like, the things they're making are disappearing into the ether at some point.
Uh-huh.
But everything we make does. Like, I used to... Absolutely. I used to go a bit far afield, but I used to write for magazines.
Alex?
Uh-oh.
Of issues. Oh, like, I can pick those up and say, like, oh, I made this. But I never do. Like, I know I have it in my memory, and that's all I need. And so the fact that I now write for a website and do fantastic streams like this that are much harder to preserve is okay. And that's just how we are these days.
Nothing is forever in the world, right? And so it eventually all goes away. So, you know.
I am Rich Lambert. Look upon my works, ye mighty, and despair.
Yeah.
I have a little bit of a kooky outlook on life, I guess.
We're sort of running out of time. This has been a great hour. I think the chat's really loving it too. I'm here seeing in the chat here that even though we've got some ESO players who aren't necessarily designers, they're loving hearing kind of this talk about game design in the chat.
Awesome.
It looks like the chat doesn't have any last-minute questions right now, but I'm going to just go ahead and give a call. If anyone in the chat has any last questions for Rich before we close up shop today, go ahead and type them in now, and we will do our best to answer. Alex, have you got any sort of questions you want to ask for Rich while we're here?
Any questions for Rich? Any more questions for Rich? Questions? Yeah, I mean, I have tons more questions for Rich. But
a book! You wanted to ask him about books, didn't you? You wanted to ask him about books.
Yeah, Rich, what are you reading right now, if you're reading anything in particular?
So, I am more of an audiobook guy.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm getting there too, yeah.
So, and mostly because I don't have a ton of free time, and when I do have free time, it's because I want to spend it playing games. Mm-hmm. So, I have about a 20-minute drive into work every day, you know, mm-hmm. 20 minutes there, 20 minutes back. And so I started audiobooking and listening to audiobooks.
Yeah.
And so I've gone through a ton of audiobooks over the last couple of years. Right now I'm listening to the Cycle of Iran trilogy.
Oh, I've never heard of it.
I haven't heard of that one.
It's written, let me see here. I got my phone right here. It's written by Edward Robinson or Robertson. Mm-hmm. And it's this really cool storyline about a young boy basically figuring out how to control magic, mm-hmm. and his exploits through there. So it's a trilogy, and then there's another book on top of that. But Girl with All the Gifts is one that I just finished. Girl with All the Gifts, mm-hmm. Was one that I just finished recently, which is amazing. Ready Player One, I just finished not too long ago as well, which is a freaking fantastic book. So I kind of listen to everything.
Mm-hmm. That's it. We were actually just talking yesterday. How do you feel that some of these books influence your work? Like, how do you feel that reading books like this affects you as a game designer?
I think that they are a great way to be inspired.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to go through and not necessarily from a mechanical point of view, mm-hmm. but just from a storytelling and how they present characters in the world. You know, mm-hmm. that's a huge part of what we do as designers is tell stories. And so how do you tell those stories? And in books, they can only do it through words. But you can take a lot of the, you know, alliteration and things like that and put that into your game and figure out how to... show the player the story that you have written down. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I mean, there's tons of amazing books out there that you can pull inspiration from. But
yeah.
It's not just books, too. Like, it's other games, it's, you know, TV shows, it's movies, it's even watching sports. You know, there's things that you can pull out of if you're, you know, paying attention or, you know, looking at how the games are structured or, you know, how the playoff systems are structured that you can lean on for inspiration.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's important. It's something we were talking about too. Like, for anyone who does creative work, that just to remain open-minded and curious, like whether you're making games and you go to read books or look at sports scores or whether you're writing about games and you go to watch movies or go to art museums or just hang out at the beach. Like, in some way, like, being open to new, like, because personally, I don't know about you, but I often feel like when I get home from work, if it hasn't been a fulfilling day or if you know, I got everything done, like, I should be doing more. Like, I should be thinking about new projects or, like, thinking about side projects and like, yep. I'm not being productive enough. Yeah. And in a weird way, I've found personally, and maybe you can echo this, like, if I have to make time to not be productive in order to be more effective when I actually go to work. And that's been something that I've only recently sort of started to come to grips with.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely need to be able to find a way to turn your brain off. That's what I call it, right? When yeah. I get home, how do I turn my brain off so that, you know, I can function when I go in the next day?
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard to not take the stresses from work mm-hmm. home. And so, you know, fortunately, my wife is very understanding when I, you know, say I have to work till 2 o'clock in the morning, or I come home and I'm all pissed off for the first hour when I'm home because something, you know, shitty happened at work. But,
right.
You know, it's finding that outlet. How do you turn your brain off? You know, I can play games sometimes to turn my brain off. Other times I like to play golf, and I also like to woodwork. And so I have, you know, a shop in my garage that, you know, when I really can't turn my brain off, I just go in and I fill around, you know, building things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But everybody needs an outlet.
Before we go, I'm just going to go ahead and grab those questions from the chat for you. Wicked Wolf would like to know, and I'm going to be a little kinder in how I phrase this, because this is almost sounding, it's in-universe racism. He wants to know, do you ever regret playing the Altmer, and would you consider playing the Nords? They've been ragging on you in the chat about that.
One of the characters that I stream on is a cat, but he's part of the Aldmeri Dominion.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I mean, I have characters in all the alliances, so I don't
think...
But do
you roleplay?
Yeah.
I don't. I'm more of the achiever. I'm one of those that has to collect all the items and has to run, you know, the really hard content.
Yeah.
Well, so I don't necessarily roleplay as much as some of our other people do, but...
Yeah. Yeah, and as far as other questions, there's some sort of direct... There's some kind of direct game questions that I think they've been talking about with each other.
Okay.
But I'm glad you could answer as to why you love your Ultimate character. Well, cool. This has been really fun. Elder Scrolls Online, I mean, like I said, this has been my first few. We're kind of in my second major push through the game. Y'all are making something really cool here. Thanks for joining us today to talk about this stuff. Just before we sign off, this is Rich Lambert. He is the creative director of Elder Scrolls Online. I'm Brian Francis. I'm the contributing editor to Gamasutra. And Alex, you are?
Yeah, I'm just another editor at Gamasutra.
Just another Joe.
Yeah.
Well, cool.
I make a website.
Yeah, this was a lot of fun. And thank you all for coming out.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, guys.
All right.
Cheers.
Signing off.